Good evening, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. And as we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program with Mayukh Sen and Angela Garbes, presented in partnership with BookLarder. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Our friends over at BookLarder have copies of Mayukh and Angela's books, and you can find books at their website. Thank you, that's great, holding it up for us. And I'll go ahead and pop links in the chat to, everybody has one but me. Oh, mine's in the next room. I'll get it while you guys are talking. But I'll put links in the chat for folks that, you know, if you want the direct link to BookLarder so you can get a copy of that there. I also wanted to let you know that we have closed captioning available for tonight's event. And to access the closed captioning, you just click on the icon at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And after tonight's conversation, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. Now I am delighted to introduce Meghna Jurati, who will introduce tonight's speakers. Hi, Meghna.
Hi, Stesha. Thanks so much. It's such a pleasure to be here with all of you, and we're really excited to be able to co-host this event with the Seattle Public Library. We, again, do have copies of Tastemakers here at BookLarder. We'll share those links in the chat for anyone who'd like to grab a copy. It's my great pleasure to introduce Mayukh Sen and Angela Garbes, our speakers tonight. Mayukh Sen is the author of Tastemakers, Seven Immigrant Women Who Revolutionized Food in America. He has won a James Beard and an IACP award for his food writing, and his work has been anthologized in two editions of the Best American Food Writing. He teaches food journalism at New York University and lives in Brooklyn, where he's joining us from tonight. We're also joined by Angela Garbes. She's the author of Like a Mother, an NPR Best Book of the Year and finalist for the Washington State Book Award in nonfiction. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, The Cut, New York, and featured on NPR's Fresh Air. She also co-hosts The Double Shift, an acclaimed podcast challenging the status quo of motherhood in America. Angela lives in Seattle with her family here. Thank you both for joining us. It's such a pleasure to have you here, and thanks for taking the time to talk to our audience today.
Thank you for having us, and yeah, thank you, Angela, for being in conversation with me. I will not bore the audience with too many words about how big a fan I am of your work, but it has taught me so much, so thank you for devoting time tonight. Real quick, before we do dive into questions, I do want to just read a bit from the introduction of my book, if that's okay, just to that's give everyone amazing. A little taste of my words. Pun very much intended, I'm sorry, okay? This shouldn't take too long, so get ready. Let me just get my glasses on, excuse me. Okay. One question may hang over you as you read this book. Why is a man writing this? It's a justified question. I'm aware that I present as a cis male to the public, and I prefer to use the privileges afforded to me because of that to amplify the voices of women whom our cultural attention skews away from. I am sensitive to the limits of this very hand, which is why I feel it is crucial to decenter myself in the process of writing rather than interject or cast judgment on my subjects. The more elaborate response I have to such a concern is that I, like many queer identifying people, have had a complex, evolving relationship to gender expression throughout my entire life. I realize that my appearance might belie this tension. This project is intensely personal, forged by my own sense of isolation in this field as a queer person of color. I began writing about food professionally in 2016 when I was 24. Even then, I could sense that I was writing from a center of gravity that differed from those of my peers as a queer child of Bengali immigrants to America. Early in my career, perhaps these feelings directed my narrative gaze toward story subjects who, like me, once felt that they did not belong. These figures tend to be people of color, queer people, women, or immigrants. Often they were even part of more than one of those groups. Their trajectories invigorated me. They floated on the margins of the food world when they first landed in it, only to push their way to the center by sheer force. These subjects had something to say. They were persuasive enough to get powerful people to listen. With time, I would come to understand what it's like to have people reduce me to my identity. The very aspects of myself that once seemed like liabilities, my queerness, my color, also started to make me, in a word, marketable. Actual engagements with the substance of my work suddenly secondary to those superficial factors. No matter the case, the acute sense of alienation I entered this industry with does not fade easily. There will always be a sliver of me that feels as though I'm on the margins of the food world, the margins of this country's dominant social structures. Maybe the answer to why I gravitate towards the stories of these women lies somewhere in my identity, how lonely I often feel because of it and what I create from that solitude. Around the time I wrote this book, I also weathered two particularly difficult losses. I lost my father to cancer in 2017, and I lost a best friend to mental illness in 2020. These deaths weighed on me. I found myself forgetting so much about these people who'd been such vital presences in my own life, their voices, their mannerisms. I understood the fragility of memory, how easily the essence of a person can disappear once they're no longer around. Writing is one way of ensuring someone's story doesn't die along with them. The seven women in this book have been my teachers. Through spending time with their stories, I've come to question and ultimately better understand my own place in America. I hope these women will inspire a similar journey for you. That's all. Thank you.
Sorry, did I? Okay, I'm unmuting. We don't have the benefit of having a room of people to clap, so I am unabashedly clapping for you.
Thank you.
It's so interesting because I was going to talk to you about how one of the questions I had for you is how you, there's a point where I'm trying to decenter myself. I'm going to let my voice fade. And I think in some ways why that works is because the introduction is so intimate and so personal. And I wasn't totally ready for you to go there. And I'm so glad that you did. So thank you for sharing that.
Sorry to catch you off guard there.
No, please. I love it. I mean, I'm such an easy cry. Like I love, all of my emotions are like just below the surface. So, and you know, on a personal note, I want to thank you so much for inviting me to do this conversation with you because it is like truly an honor. We're not going to bore everyone, but there's a mutual love and admiration of work that's been going on for years now. And this is the first time we've got to meet and talk. And I feel really, just really fortunate to be able to be in conversation with you. So thank you for inviting me to do it with you.
Of course. Thank you.
You know, I think I want to say too, that introduction that you wrote, if it resonates personally for me, you know, I don't write about food anymore, but I started off my career as a food writer. And I very much gravitated to similar subjects. And I know that I did it because I grew up a very lonely person who was always looking for myself in stories and in the media that I loved to consume, whether that was television or books and magazines and books. Sorry, I said books because I was worried that I led with television. But yeah, I mean, I definitely started writing about food and the subjects that I did because I wanted to very much write myself and my people and my friends and my family into the narratives that I was consuming that didn't have us. So so that, you know, I wanted to start with a question that is really about, you know, I've been waiting for your book for years since like the day you announced it, which was like 3 years ago. And before that, you were obviously working on a proposal. So this book has probably been 4 years or something in the making. And, you know, writing a book is a very exhausting and rewarding and frankly torturous experience all at once. Mm-hmm. But you get into the afterword of your book here. And so I feel like I'm zooming ahead, but I found the afterword so interesting. Like the question is, sorry, I'll shut up now. The question is, you know, in the research and the process of writing this book, you had to sort of narrow it down to this roster of seven women, right? And in the book, you urge people to really think about whose stories get told and whose stories do not get told. And I wondered what it was like to suddenly find yourself as someone who hoped to be represented and wanted to center these voices What was it like to find yourself in the position of making those kinds of decisions?
It felt like a total burden, to be honest. And I think that's exactly how it should have felt, you know, because it did feel like a great responsibility, you know, because I did have the hope that, I don't know, more than three people would read this book. And I think that I might have a few more readers than that, right? And as a result, you know, many of those folks might come to this book not knowing the names of so many women whose labor is really essential to the way that America cooks and eats today and generally thinks about food. And so I needed to make sure that if I was in a position where I was putting someone's story to paper for the first time in a very long time, that I was doing so with as much care and sensitivity as possible. So it did feel like a real point of stress for me to be in the position where I was suddenly curating, so to speak, you know, this gallery of lives, especially because so many immigrant women throughout American history have really impacted the way that America eats today. And yet they do not, you know, get chapters devoted to them in this book. So in terms of the process and kind of how I winnowed, so to speak, you know, I will say, first of all, that you're exactly right that I sold my proposal 3 years ago, and the seven women who are in that proposal are not the same seven women who ended up in this book. You know, at first I really looked for women whose
Are they a totally different group of seven, or
it's just a few substitutions, you know, like two or three.
We don't need to get specific, just curious.
It's not a total facelift, but you know, my first kind of criteria was really asking myself, well, what is it about, you know, this woman's story that is compelling in pure narrative terms? Because one thing that I knew I did not want to do in writing this book is to write it for a very specific kind of food literate audience, because it is so easy, kind of, you know, once you set foot in the food media, to narrow your audience and speak to a very, very specific inside baseball kind of crowd, you know, the people who know who Craig Claiborne is, for example, who's he was, for anyone who does not know in the audience, he was the food editor of the New York Times beginning in 1957. I wanted to write for a wider audience because I myself was someone who grew up not consuming food writing in any way, and there should be room for readers like that to exist in our work. So that was kind of the first step. But then once I got to the actual writing stage post-proposal, I realized that so many of the women I'd chosen in that proposal stage, they did not, you know, so many of them were deceased, and they had not left behind memoirs or cookbooks with memoiristic passages, or they had not given a wealth of interviews that really presented them speaking in their own voice, because I really wanted to understand how these women sought to present themselves to the public. And then I wanted to reconcile that with the way that, you know, the American food media of the day perceived them, and I want to see where those two align, where those diverge, and so on. Yet, you know, in some cases, there is just not enough extant material to really mine. And so I had to kind of go back to the drawing board and ask myself, well, who has a memoir that, you know, I can really, you know, visit to understand how she wanted the world to see her? And then I went from there. And so I ended with the seven women I did, you know, and all of them either did have, or most of them did have memoirs or books of some sort that presented them speaking in their own voices. Two of them were alive. And then one of them had, thank goodness, you know, she'd given a wealth of interviews in her lifetime that were enough material for me to come through. So,
yeah, I mean, I think it's so interesting that, first of all, that your charge to yourself was to start with how did they present themselves? How did they want to speak about themselves? Because I think that there are a lot of people who are not interested in that, right? Like that narrative. And I think that that, you know, I think about what you said too. It's like someone didn't give very many interviews, but that's because not that many people asked for an interview.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. So I think that there's, and I guess I just want to give a little like shout out to Desta Bairu, I guess, is that how you pronounce your name? Because that really moved me in the afterword where you said, like, I initially planned to include this woman who was a major force for Ethiopian and Eritrean food in America. And, you know, people here who are in Seattle know we have a huge East African population and we are blessed with many Ethiopian restaurants. And so I'm sure that there is a way to trace that back to her. But because there's that lack of material for you to work with, she didn't make it into the book. So I think, I mean, I think that's a really interesting, that your charge required to hear their voices first and foremost, but that also, like, so you're relying on, you know, people who were doing your job, yes, you know, or jobs similar to yours decades ago, and, you know, we're making up for a lack, right? That's the...
Exactly. Yeah. And that's why, you know, in my afterword, readers will see that, you know, I kind of put a call to action basically for food journalists like myself to, you know, really seek out the trust of sources from these marginalized communities, let's say, or communities whose stories are often undertold in the American mm-hmm. food media, to make yes. sure that, you know, we are recording their stories. Unless we give, or the, not we, I don't have any capital, you know, but, you know,
the we turn it all over to them.
Right, exactly. Yeah, yeah. No, unless, you know, those who do have material power within the American food media give, you know, these folks from marginalized communities enough capital to tell these stories themselves and write those memoirs, for example, right. so that, you know, we make up for this deficit in some way historically. Yeah. And so
I guess, yeah, I mean, the afterword, spoiler alert, guys. Mayukh definitely says, you know, like, I, you know, it's not on you. I should also say, like, it is not your responsibility to cover everyone. There's too many women, right, who have been excluded from this. But I like that call to action, right? It's action oriented, it's solution oriented, which is that, you know, you are right, consider this an invitation, right, to mm-hmm. find people. And I also love the idea too of, like, you need to build trust with sources. It's not go find these people and write about them. It is build trust with these people. And I think, you know, this is again the end of the book, but, you know, if there's one thing we take away from this evening, I'd like to start in that place, which is that this book really is a, I don't know, I see it as like a gentle challenge to a lot of people, right? And I think I appreciate too that it's very much to try to speak to a wider audience about a subject that a lot of people like to think is like niche. But to like open that up and show that we have, it's not just giving people material capital, it is also giving up some of your own. To, yes. to give that to people.
Absolutely.
So I just sort of wanted to start there because I think the book is challenging in that way, in a way that I like to think people are ready for.
Fingers crossed, right? You know, that's my hope. Yeah. Yet, you know, sometimes my readers surprise me in bad ways. So that's okay. You know, I love so many of them, so it's okay.
Yeah. I mean, I think we need everyone. So I feel like people come in at different levels, right?
Totally.
And that kind of leads into the next question that I had for you, which is something that I think about a lot as a writer, and specifically a writer of color. I wanted to know how you approached the question of audience, or imagined the audience that you were writing for, to what extent you did that at all, right? Like, I feel like I'm, as a writer of color, I'm often encouraged to like not write for anyone but myself, which I love the idea of that, but to the extent that I've internalized whiteness and have a desire to please people and to be accepted, I can't fully, sometimes I wonder if I really know what it would be like to do that.
Absolutely.
When I was reading your introduction, I was really struck. You talked about these stories and you said, you know, these stories should make you uncomfortable. These stories should make you squirm. And I urge you to think about like, what immigrant stories are deemed worthy of telling and what immigrant stories are deemed not worthy of telling. Mm-hmm. And so when I read that, I mean, I've been thinking about these things for a long time, but so when I read it as possibly like a challenge to a specific audience, maybe a white audience. Definitely. But I don't know if that's just me. Like, I don't know if you don't see it that way, or do you see it as a challenge to everyone? Do you see it as like a calling in? I would just love to know.
Yes, no, that's such a sharp question. I thank you so much for asking it. So I did constantly think, as I was writing this book, about, you know, whom do you write for? Right. You know, who's your audience?
For whom do you write?
Exactly, right? You know, that's the perennial question that haunts so many writers. It should haunt many writers. And I felt as though this book was really my first and certainly largest opportunity to truly decenter that white audience for mm-hmm. whom I had written throughout my entire food writing career, because for audience members who are not familiar with my career trajectory, which is probably everyone, I got my start at a site called Food 52 back in 2016 when I was 24 years old, as I said in that intro. And, you know, readers could be really ruthless there. And when they saw a name like mine and a non-white face, you know, in otherwise, you know, a site that was otherwise populated by many white women's bylines, yeah. You know, yeah, exactly. You know, it was there was a real sense of disturbance among the readership, and it resulted in truly dispiriting, I can say, emails to me, comments, whatever. And as a result, what I kind of had to do, I adopted a survival strategy in which I began to write for those sorts of readers to make sure I was not offending them because they made my life hell otherwise in some way. And it's really tough to kind of find yourself in a position where you are trying to placate that certain segment of the audience while also keeping your own community in mind and making sure that you are doing right by marginalized communities who may not see themselves in a site like Food 52, which I did also feel like a really vital part of my work there.
I mean, that's a lot to put on yourself at age 24.
Totally. And I felt that. It was definitely not easy. But, you know, when I began writing this book, you know, I was like, okay, finally, I can center a different kind of reader. And so as I was writing each of these chapters, I thought about, oh, well, what does, you know, what would a reader who belongs to this community or these communities that this woman belongs to, you know, how they feel about this characterization of their cuisine or their culture? And I kind of, you know, when I was writing the chapter on Julie Sani, who is from India, for example, I thought about that myself. I asked myself, would this characterization of Indian cooking strike me as tonally odd or offensive in some way, and kind of rewrote from there? Yet, you know, there are some moments in which that past self of mine who was writing for that white, liberal presenting audience, let's say, was still present. And I think that that line that you just identified in my introduction is absolutely one of them, because I know that there are going to be so many people who pick up this book and are like, yeah, I want to know how America became this culinary melting pot where you can
value the work of women of color.
Exactly. Yes. You know, and it's this sort of like self-congratulatory gesture. And there's, you know, that curiosity that they might have when they pick up the book that I don't want to judge in any way. And I just know that that is a reality that, or at least hopefully a reality of, you know, who my reader or some of my readers might be. And I want to challenge those people to think beyond, you know, the labor of immigrants is just, a means to an end, and that end being the sort of object that is consumed by, you know, those who have privilege, because not to yap on too much, you know.
No, but, please, this is what we're here for.
Yeah, you know, I'm just thinking about the genesis of this book, and, you know, I was really motivated to write it, write the proposal in 2018, and that was after a year of just seeing so many talking points in the American food media that said immigrants get the job done and immigrants feed America, which I, you know, if I'm being generous, they're quite well-intentioned, factually correct, sure. Yet to me, they often came from these white-led publications, and they simply existed to, placate a certain reader whom the American food media has privileged for so long. That person is usually middle to upper middle class and white, and the labor of immigrants themselves becomes obscured in such a configuration. And as someone who is literally born to immigrants, you know, I wanted to, I was disturbed by that sort of a narrative turn that I was seeing. And so I felt as though the best way for me to correct that within my very, very limited skill set as a storyteller was to tell the stories of, you know, these individual immigrants who did labor and really honor their struggle as much as possible. Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, I too was always troubled by that idea, like immigrants get the job done, like let's we should acknowledge this labor, but also our labor, and I say our, I mean, I'm a child of immigrants, and I think about like our people generally, right. It's as though also like, is our labor what makes us valuable? Like that's what should be recognized. What about just for existing, say? Like,
exactly.
You know what I mean? Like the worth of a life, the worth of a dish made for no one else outside of the home.
Totally.
Right? Like these kinds of things are, it tends to assign, you know, worth to what you do.
Right, exactly.
Who you are, or just for existing.
And yeah, that is what is so disturbing to me about these talking points. You're essentially, measuring the worth and value of an immigrant's life based on their productivity. And I really, really wanted to correct for that, because I saw very few people around me in the American food media challenging the proliferation of those talking points. So this is my attempt.
I love it. I mean, I think it is a, I think you succeed. I should say that. And I also think that there's like, it, to me, it's like such a start. You know, I remember thinking, as I was reading your book, I was reminded of how I felt when I found out that you were writing it, where I was like, yes, like we need a book like this. And we need a book from someone like you, right? Like from a child of immigrants who sees this as like, I've always been this sort of, I don't know, there's this discomfort I've always felt as a child of immigrants where I feel like my job has always been to like translate the world to my parents, like my parents to the world, right? And then also sort of, but I think that's like what you were saying in terms of when you think about an audience, right? I think that's, it's so true that there's that little tell, because you're speaking to some people, you want to speak to your people to say like, I know, right? Like I'm representing us, I'm doing it right, I'm doing it meticulously and carefully, right? But then you also want to, you want to sell a book, right? you want to include people whose stories are appealing to lots of people. Right. I think that there's something too, and we all manage this, you know, like making a living in capitalism and, you know, balancing art and creativity and being able to support ourselves. But I think there is also something from our generation of people, like first generation Americans, where we can't help but see things all the time from like two different perspectives. And a lot of it is trying to reconcile that, or I don't know, or find a, maybe I'm just projecting. But to me, I think it's trying to find a way to put those things together. Like I always felt like when I'm writing, I want people who are like me, I want them to get it. I want them to see all the things that they're thinking about represented. And then people who have never thought about this before, I don't want to make them totally comfortable. I want to make them uncomfortable, but I also want to like invite them in. I want them to find a way. And I think that these stories do that because there's an emotional touchstone for people, you know, like, I don't know. I mean, like some of these women are like contemporaries of my mom, you know what I mean? And so they're like, they're her age. Like one of the, you know, I think Craig Claiborne comes up, Julia Child comes up as like these sort of like specters and forces. But I loved how, you know, the 1965 Hart Sellers Act is like a specter that comes up, which is totally the reason for my family's immigration to the United States. And so I think that there's just these, in these stories, there are these places to pull people in to engage them on multiple levels.
Oh, well, I'm relieved to hear that because that was absolutely my intention, you know, to make sure that there is some sort of a kind of pulse to each of these stories rather than just you know, having them be kind of chronological, staid, lifeless, you know, retellings of someone's life as, you know, a glossy Wikipedia page, essentially. So,
well, so I want to talk about, I mean, I feel like we need to get into these women. Mm-hmm. It seems like, I mean, I want to ask you so many questions because I feel like you're so generous and you're like, use of sources, like how you think about people's names and, you know, how, but so there's a lot that I wanted to get to in my like nerdy writer mind, but I mean, it would just be like, I'd be remiss not to spend some time with these women. I was really shocked to find myself of all the women in this book. I mean, I think not that it's not about favorites, but the opening chapter of Chow Bu Wei really just shook me. But I was really shocked to find myself like really feeling a lot of empathy for Madeline Kamen. Is it Kamen? Kamen?
Yeah, you know, I've heard different pronunciations, but the way that she said it on her TV show was Kamen. So we'll go with that.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, I was like, obviously I'm like ratting with Chow. Like, obviously I'm like Julie Sani, Najma, I'm there. Yeah. And then, but then I was like, this French lady, oddly moving to me.
Oh yeah, totally.
You know, the way that she was, you used a phrase like, the sexist dog whistles, right? Mm-hmm. Which I think is like very, the most like women in modern America, like
totally
recognized in her sort of outspokenness. But I wanted to know, like when you were, I don't know if there's someone that you particularly want to talk about. I wondered if there's a story that came to mind, like when you were doing your research or conducting an interview where you were like, I cannot wait.
Oh yeah.
Listen to the book. Yeah. If you have one or two of those, I just love to hear.
Oh man. I mean, you know, it was so many, there's so many kind of anecdotes embedded in each of these chapters that I felt that way about, but you know, you brought up Madeline Kamen and she's such an exciting figure to talk about because, you know, audience members who aren't familiar with her, she was a French born chef and restaurateur and cooking teacher, cookbook author. She did it all. She was absolutely brilliant. Her first cookbook came out in the early 1970s, I believe, and she was quite prolific during her lifetime. Yet, in spite of her many, many achievements, and in spite of the fact that she was very well decorated by the food establishment with such awards as the James Beard Award, you know, she was often characterized in the press as the sort of antagonist of Julia Child's because she dared to speak out against figures like Julia Child and Paul Bocuse, the French-born chef, for the power that they wielded and the privileges that they had that allowed them to rise to such prominence in the American minds. And in revisiting Madeleine Kamen's story, because she unfortunately passed away a few years ago, I really saw the story of a woman who was punished for, being outspoken and being outspoken against powerful people and punching up constantly and really paying the price for it. And I sympathize with her immensely, in spite of the fact that, in pure demographic terms, we're so different, right? We're talking about like this blue-eyed white French lady and this, queer brown kid who was born in 1992, right? I felt so much empathy for her because she did arguably come from a marginalized community in the sense that she was an immigrant from France. And she was quite righteous in her anger, towards those figures whom I just mentioned. And yet I found, just in looking and sifting through so many documents and, writing on her during her lifetime, I found so little desire from chroniclers of that era, to really understand where her anger was coming from. And I thought of my own experiences within food media, because I've been here for 5 years now inexplicably, and there have absolutely been times when, especially early in my career, when I punched up as well, and I did feel a sense of silencing from those who had a lot of power and a lot more power than and material power than I will ever possess, in this lifetime, certainly. And it's really horrible to feel that way. You feel so small and you feel as though all the work that you have done to prove yourself just does not matter in those moments in which someone tries to reduce you to an agitator. And so I had tremendous empathy for Madeleine Kamen's position, and I wanted to really write against all of the scholarship and journalism, you could say, that had existed on her thus prior, and really examine her story as one of just pure, sexist mistreatment at the hands of the American food establishment and American food media. And so, I mean, there are so many stories within just her narrative that really upset me and made me so just angry, just the way that, people talked about her departure from Boston, which is, the city around which she was working for a very long time in her career. They just characterized her as a sort of failure who was, giving up on everything, going back to her native France, et cetera. And it's so cruel, And it really, there were probably times when I cried when writing that chapter, and I'm not too much of a softie, but her story really got me in that way. And so I'm totally relieved to hear that, you also sympathize with her.
No, same thing, like demographically didn't see it coming, right? But then totally. And there's something that you said that I think is really, there's an interlude about Julia Child. And I feel like it kind of nails part of what happens. Obviously she was pitted against, there was this rivalry, this perceived rivalry or created rivalry, manufactured. Yeah, for sure. But this idea though, that the thing that all of these women had, which is that they were outsiders fundamentally, right? And that's an immigrant status, right? And Julia Child never was that. And it seems like such an obvious point, but when I read it in your book, I was like, oh, right? And that's where it is, with Madeleine, who is a white woman, right? And class-wise, similar, right? But that's what it is. It's that outsider again. I think that's a theme that's been coming up, right? The idea of looking to the margins for stories and who is there on the margins.
Right, totally. Yeah, and I'm very curious to see what the perception of that little interlude, as I call it, about Julia Child is, because I'm sure that some ungenerous readers might feel as though I'm trying to cancel Julia Child or something. Yet I have a lot of love and affection for her. I have tremendous respect for everything that she did to advance the cause of French cooking in America and cooking generally in America, right? She brought it to Americans a completely different way in so many respects. Yet what I really want to show with this book is that there should be room in the American mind for all of these women. It doesn't have to be Julia versus Madeleine and right. Julia wins, that kind of thing. Why not both of them?
Can create more space as opposed to positioning women as fighting over a very small amount of space.
Exactly. It's that whole kind of what people today call scarcity mindset, you know, right, in operation. And, you know, this is something that I really struggled with as I was writing each of these chapters, because, you know, I don't want to name specific figures out of respect to them, but, you know, there were some, you know, women whom I focused my chapters on in this book who, you know, might not be as well known as, you know, their contemporaries within that same space, you know, or, you know, people who had cooked the same cuisine that these women, you know, had made a name for themselves cooking. And the last thing that I wanted to do in my chapters was to be like, well, why wasn't she as famous as this person who had written a cookbook, you know, around that same time? No, I didn't want to do that. It's so insulting to someone's memory and, you know, also to someone who's still alive to say, you know, this person is overlooked and forgotten in some ways. Is that how she feels about herself? You know, and that's something that I really want to keep in mind. And I think it kind of ties back to this idea of decentering a white audience. You know, I think early on in my career, I wrote so much about these so-called forgotten figures, right? You know, people who had been misremembered, but I was never quite naming who was doing the misremembering. And it was really white cultural memory. And I want to be quite specific about that sort of framing in this book, without kind of condescending to the stories of these women, because I think that when you do frame certain stories as overlooked or forgotten in some way, you are essentially doing more to, I guess, reify this dynamic than really challenge it, so.
Right, because the stories are there to be discovered.
Exactly, yes, and you
with,
know, they're—
with effort, yeah. Yes. But they're, it's like when people say, like, I don't know, it's a little bit like, oh, I'm giving you're giving voice to the voiceless. Like, no. They have a voice. Totally. Absolutely. They're waiting for someone to hear it, right? Like, that's part of that. I think, you know, one of the things that I love about this is it's a book that really challenges the notion of success, or it troubles the notion or the traditional American notion of success. And I mean, I'd love for you to talk with these women, how they defined success for themselves. Mm-hmm. Was different, right? And maybe they were not commercially successful in some ways, and obviously there were disappointments. Right. But I think that one of the things that the book does is show that many of these women did achieve success on their own terms.
Exactly. Yes. Could
share some, you know, with people who haven't read the book yet, maybe like a couple of examples of that.
Totally. Yeah. So, you know, some of these women, especially the subjects of my earlier chapters, I do feel as though they certainly saw assimilating to the so-called American way, let's say that is the white, middle, upper middle class American way, as being a sign of success, and, you know, endearing themselves to the food establishments and having their cooking also reflect this new sense of place in an almost patriotic way. I think the most potent example that comes to mind is that of Elena Zelayeta, who is a Mexican-born chef who was a real celebrity in her time. She had begun writing cookbooks in the 1940s, and her cookbooks at the beginning of her career were mostly Mexican and Spanish in orientation. Yet as time went on, you know, she started to write about California cuisine more generally, and she started to borrow ingredients from, you know, culinary traditions in Japan and Italy, for example, and other immigrant populations who existed within California. And, you know, she gave quite a few quotes in her lifetime that were essentially saying that, you know, I love being American, I'm proud to be American, which, you know, I, as a leftist, I'm like, oh, that's so weird. You know, that's sort of a, you know, vaguely jingoistic talking point. Yet I realized that it was not my place as a writer chronicling her story so many decades later to judge in any way or to graft my own mores onto her story. She was working under an enormously difficult set of circumstances that I just cannot imagine today. Mm-hmm. And I needed to honor that and how those struggles may have shaped her outlook. So she's one example of, you know, assimilation as seeing assimilation as a path to success. But there are other women in my book, especially ones in later chapters, who felt as though assimilating was not the only path to success. You know, one example is that of Najmieh Batmanglij from Iran. She was someone who came to America in the early 1980s after having fled Iran as a refugee around the time of the Iranian Revolution. And when she came to America in the early 1980s, she tried to sell an English language Iranian cookbook. Yet, you know, that was again the time when the revolution cast such a long shadow and the Iran hostage crisis still loomed large in the American mind. And as a result, she got just a polite rejection or total silence from publishers. And the message really was that, you know, publishing an Iranian cookbook, in that time was just anathema to major publishers. And as a result, what she did was she and her husband, Muhammad, they just partnered together. They created their own publishing house, and they worked outside the confines of the limited imagination of the American food publishing landscape to really, make an impact. And she published her first English language cookbook, Food of Life, in the mid 1980s. And now many home cooks might recognize that as a work of great, tremendous importance. It is the tome of, Iranian cooking in America. Yet, to make that happen and to become the legend that she is today, she had to circumvent, the food, the American food media, and
had to do it online.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I think it's, to me, it was notable that you ended the book with Norma Shirley. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm assuming everything that you did in this book is very intentional, just knowing you and reading your process. Right. But I mean, what I love is with Norma Shirley's story, it was like, I'll just leave.
Exactly.
Like, I don't need to. And I loved that as a way of sort of ending the book and pointing to possibilities, which is that you literally don't have to stay, right? Oh. And play by these rules. Like, mm-hmm. you can, and by the lack of imagination that's there.
Exactly. Yes. And, I don't want to go over too much before we get to questions, but
I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt to say that we don't have any questions in the Q&A yet. So in a few minutes, we're going to switch to audience questions. So I would encourage all of you, if you have any questions for Mayukh, to go ahead and put that in the Q&A.
Please do. Regarding Norma Shirley's story, you were absolutely right that it was very, very intentional to put her story last. For those audience members who aren't familiar with her, she was a Jamaican-born chef who she worked in America as a chef and restaurant owner in the 1970s in the Berkshires in Massachusetts. And she was cooking French food with Jamaican flair, is what she called it. And then in the early 1980s, she moved to New York and she decided to maybe try mounting her own restaurant that reflected that same sensibility. Yet she lacked so much access to capital and investors that could have made that dream a reality for her. And she faced so many challenges as a Black immigrant woman from the Caribbean. And so as a result, she was like, you know what? I'm not going to stay in America. This isn't worth it. I'm going to go back home. And so it was only in the mid-1980s when she returned home to Jamaica and began her own restaurants under her own name that she became a star to the American food media. At that mm-hmm. point, so many magazines and publications began fainting her as, the Julia Child of Jamaica and the Julia Child of the Caribbean, which are, mm-hmm. to my mind, troubling kind of, labels. Yet, yeah. She truly did gain the respect of the American food establishment, but she literally had to leave, mm-hmm. America for that to happen. And so I do hope that readers see that as something that is quite embarrassing, for a disruption, certainly, of this very tidy notion of America as this wonderful, rich culinary melting pot.
Yeah, I mean, the idea that you could be accepted when you were no longer, I don't want to say a threat, right? Mm-hmm. But when you're at a safe distance, right? Like, people want to see things presented by people that they know, right? Mm-hmm. Or in some format that they feel more comfortable with. And that idea mm-hmm. of just rejecting that and finding freedom in that is, I think that's beautiful. I don't want people to have to leave the country to do that, but that idea of creating your own, mm-hmm. What Najma and Norma, and Najma is still alive. So what Najma does and what Norma did, mm-hmm. which was to sort of like expand, right? And not exactly. be limited by what's put on you.
Yeah, it's so aspirational. Yeah.
Yeah. I did just want to say, I'm going to switch to our questions here because they're rolling in. I wanted to go back to this idea of assimilation. Because I think it is really, it's tricky to do it. And I find myself as, a first generation immigrant child, I've always rejected, I've seen, my parents always urged assimilation as a way of being successful, and that was the goal, really, is assimilation.
Yeah.
And to get to a place where you can write about that, I don't know what your journey has been with that, to get to a place where you can write about that without being judgmental, and seeing it that assimilation in many ways is about survival, yes. right? For a lot of people, we're just not very, I think culturally, and generationally, we're not so far from assimilation mm-hmm. as the goal.
Totally, yeah.
So I just wanted to just compliment you on that. I think.
Oh, well, thank you. You know, I do have to say that, you know, a lot of, you know, that happened by just kind of looking inward, you know, as I wrote in the introduction, you know, you won't see the first person in any of these chapters, you know, because I don't feel I'm interesting enough as a character in narrative terms to, you know, justify my presence in the first person in these chapters in any way. Like, who wants to hear me be like, here's what I think, you know, like, who cares? Yet, you know, I do look at my own, you know, trajectory just within these past 5 years, and someone could very well just kind of look at my CV or whatever and say, oh, well, here's someone who, you know, he pursued assimilation. Because when I came to food media so unexpectedly 5 years ago, I felt like such an outsider, and I really felt as though I had something to prove, because I needed to mitigate the sense of fraudulence that I carried with me in this industry. And so I chased, you know, recognition from certain awards bodies and publications and anthologies.
And you got it.
Yes, and that was so lovely, because it opened up so much access to capital and opportunity that otherwise would not have been easily available to me, just as a result of who I am and mm-hmm. where I come from and the communities I belong to. Yet I realized that, you know, getting those accolades, let's say, does not necessarily fulfill you in creative terms, you know? Yeah. And
was it Julie Sani's story where they said, like, you have to excel, but you have to be content?
Yes, like, yes, exactly.
Those two things are the same.
Yes, yes.
That really, that was like, you know, when I read that, I felt very, I don't know, I needed to read that. So
yes, no, I'm yeah. so
Maybe
glad.
Maybe I need to like reflect that back to you just so you can hear it.
Yeah, yeah. No, thank you for, no, but yeah, that clarified a lot for me too, that line in the Julie Sani chapter. So yeah. I hope it is the same for my readers, but I guess we can get into questions now.
Yeah, right? Let's get into questions. So Chris is asking, what did cooking and food look like when you were a kid? And who were the crucial figures in your food story?
Oh, wow. That is a wonderful question. So I grew up in a household of Bengali immigrants. They were from the Indian state of West Bengal specifically. And the person who did most of the cooking in my home was my mother, who's also my best friend. And my relationship to her certainly informs, you know, my approach to these stories, in the sense that I look at her struggles as someone who grew up in a literal village in West Bengal and did not have material privileges that I am fortunate to enjoy now. And she came to America in the early 1980s in an arranged marriage and had to acclimate to, you know, a very challenging climate, you know, a cultural climate, excuse me, you know, in New Jersey in that era. And one of her many tasks in terms of caring for me growing up was, you know, cooking. On top of keeping a full-time job and, you know, being the breadwinner in our family. And mm-hmm. so many of my food memories, you know, revolve around her cooking. She did a lot of Bengali cooking, you know, lots of what I guess I can inelegantly translate as, you know, egg curries and chicken curries. I would say fish curries as well, which are pretty elemental to Bengali cooking, but I'm actually allergic to fish, so I don't know if I was switched at birth or something like that. You know, maybe I'm not Bengali at all. Who knows? But you know, a lot of my food memories revolve around her cooking. Yet she carried and still carries a sense of humility around her own cooking, and as a result, I absorbed a lot of that. And I did not quite realize how spectacular her cooking and her artistry really was until I became a food writer. And it was only then that I could really appreciate her labor and how much love she put into mm-hmm. it, as corny as that sounds, you know? And I'm really grateful that this project has given that to me, because I always, you know, before I became a food writer, just saw food as a means for, you know, survival. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay, I'm gonna put this in my body, gonna go to bed, and then just repeats, you know.
I could just take a capsule instead.
Yeah, exactly. Right, you know, I didn't even understand food as a portal for pleasure, excuse me, I was mistaken to do that. So
it's very humbling when you as you get older and realize that your parents are people.
Totally. yeah I know.
So we've established, Stesha didn't say it directly, that Mayukh does not cook or is not a great cook, by his own admission. Yeah. But Omari is asking, I know you are not a cook, but did any of the recipes, and this is a book without recipes, I'll say, but mm-hmm. did any of the recipes from these women speak to you? And did you ever cook any? And did you take any tips and lessons from these women's writings?
Oh, that is a wonderful question. First of all, thank you for recognizing that I'm absolutely not a home cook. You know, I that's how I came to this industry, and that is probably how I'll leave it. It's certainly, you know, what I still am today. I'm a reluctant home cook. Yeah, I mean, I really resisted the temptation to put any recipes in this book for many reasons. One is that I don't think that, you know, food writing necessarily needs to have recipes to have any sort of value to the reader. You know, yeah. It can exist on its own without that service component. A, B, I wanted, you know, to resist this idea that you can flatten, you know, an entire woman's body of work to one recipe, you know, just for to make a book like mine commercially viable. And so as a result, as I was writing, you know, I did not, you know, cook a ton of recipes from the repertoires of these women. I did occasionally, you know, especially when it came to, you know, folks like Najmieh and Julie. You know, I was often, when I was spending time with them reporting on their stories, you know, that involved a lot of time in the kitchen with them as well. But, you know, I've had the great fortune of having my book excerpted in The New Yorker for the past few months. And those columns actually do have recipes tied to them. And so I was forced to get into the kitchen, you know, and it was cool to kind of meet these women in an entirely different new way, you know.
Yeah, like on their turf, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, one recipe that I really enjoyed making was a Marcella Hazan's cauliflower gratin, excuse me, which, you know, there's this whole story in the chapter and also in the excerpt about, you know, the conflict surrounding that recipe and how Italian it was or wasn't in the eyes of her editor, Judith Jones at Knopf. Yet it's a really wonderful recipe. And to me, you know, as I was cooking it, I was reminded of the fact that, you know, Marcella was really working in a time when so many American home cooks were predisposed to believe that Italian cooking was just, you know, pasta in a puddle of red sauce or spaghetti and meatballs, when in fact it was so much more, and there's so much regional nuance to Italian cooking that she wanted to honor through her work. And, you know, that recipe is an example of one, and just also tastes really damn good. So I was like, I'm gonna bring this into my dinner rotation, you know.
Excellent. There is a related question about your own favorite dish to cook or eat. I love how food writers always get asked.
Oh my God. Yeah. And it's, you'd think that I've got a good, you know, answer figured out for this. And yet I do not, you know.
What's like, is there like the last thing that you made that you really loved that you were
Man. Well, let's see. I did make the fire alarm go off a few nights ago when I was roasting a chicken. So I'm not going to say that one. But we can, you know, we can go with my favorite thing to eat. Hold on. I've got, okay, I'm like revealing myself as a sociopath here, but I've,
I've got like, here for it.
Right. Yeah, I've got a list of like my favorite food items in addition to like my favorite movies and albums and stuff like that. Somehow food is in there as well, you know? Okay, you know what? I mean, I just love, let's see, which one should I focus on today? Let's go with banana pudding today. You know, I'm a big custard kind of guy, and the banana pudding just hits the spot. Haven't
you
made
make
it
your
myself. No. This is stuff I like to consume.
Okay. You know. The question technically was about what you cook, but we'll allow.
I'm sorry. Oh my God. I said.
Do you put like Nilla wafers on the side? Because that's cooking if you.
Yes. Yeah.
Do that.
I do. Yes.
Let's call that
something. Yes. Perfect. My God. I'm sorry to completely. It was unintentional. This like skirting around the question.
It's so telling though. I love it. We were talking earlier about how people need more people who write about food or in the food world should just be honest and come out of the closet about the fact that they like the food that I have friends who are chefs, and the food they make for themselves is sometimes horrifying. You know, like you don't have energy. I think not horrifying as in it's bad, but it's not always good. Like this idea that it has to always be good is something we should release ourselves from.
Absolutely. Let's celebrate the mediocrity of our kitchen. You know?
Okay. I have a question here. Gosh, they're really good ones. There's two that I want to save because they're kind of forward thinking and I'd love to save those.
Perfect. Yeah. Yeah.
But here's someone asking, what was the process like of building trust with your subjects and their families? This to me is a really important question.
Yeah, absolutely. It was definitely complicated, you know, but I think that it was just really crucial for me early on in my communication to be clear with them about the parameters of the story, or at least as how I saw them, you know, in that time, in that stage of my writing. And I just, you know, wanted to really convince them that I had no ulterior motives in any way. I didn't want to, you know, like uncover the real Marcella Hazan or something mm-hmm. like that. You know, I just was very honest about the fact that, you know, this is who I am. You know, if you need to hear them, these are my credentials, but I'm doing this book about, you know, these seven immigrant women who really changed the way that America cooks and eats. And I was really hoping to devote a chapter to, you know, your mother, who is no longer with us, or you, Julie Sani, or you, Najmi Batmanglij. And these are kinds of the parameters of the chapter. This is what I hope it'll cover. It'll also focus on your legacy, so on and so forth. And, you know, I'm sure that along the way, I probably got some, you know, resistance from family members, but I was really fortunate in the case of, you know, Najmi Batmanglij and Najmi Batmanglij and Julie Sani in particular. You know, they immediately, you know, obliged to me, you know, writing chapters on them. And I was really, really lucky that they were able to open up to me, you know, some mm-hmm. young idiot stranger like myself, you know, like, and, you know, really
young, accomplished, handsome stranger who wants to come in and listen to them and learn from them.
Totally. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. But, you know, it's like, I think that they had every reason not to trust someone like me just because of, you know, my youth and the fact that I belong to a different, perhaps more naive generation. Yet, you know, they welcomed me in. And so I was really grateful. And so I'm so happy that I didn't face too many challenges in that regard. Yet, you know, when you are dealing with living subjects, you want to make sure that you're working around their sensitivities while still maintaining a semblance of that loaded word objectivity, you know, in your rendering of their stories. And when it comes to family members, I will say you want to make sure you're not reopening, you know, wounds, especially right. in a way that, you know, puts that woman who's no longer with us in a position where she can't defend herself based on some claim that you make about her in your writing. And I want to make sure I wasn't doing that. So that's why I try not to focus too much on this conflict, quote unquote, between Julia Child and Madeline Kamen, for example. That's unfair to both women. So
it's a delicate balancing act, what you're talking about. You know, where's the line of where the story veers into a thing that you can't, what is it? You can't fact check, like a feeling that for someone that's dead, right? So,
right.
Okay, we have so many good questions here. We technically have like 2 minutes left. I think we should go to, we talked about this earlier because I'm always like, we should end on time. Mm-hmm. But we could, maybe if we go like 5 minutes past, how do you feel about
that? That's good. Yeah. I'm going to watch General Hospital after this. So okay. catching up on my soap. So,
someone was asking, this is a question that's here. Do you have a favorite, they're asking for multiple, but do you have like a favorite story that you can share that did not make the cut into the book?
Oh, that did not make the cut. Oh my goodness. See? Oh man, there was so much left on the cutting room floor, especially because you know, this book was originally like 400 pages long, and now it's like I think it's 179 pages, and then it's 100 pages of notes. So there are many stories that did not make it in. I will say that one that immediately comes to mind is the story of Julie Sani immediately coming to America in, I believe, 1968 from India. You know, she had this wonderful story that she was still telling me about, you know, when I saw her last for an event a few weeks back, where, you know, she had come to America from India and she arrived in Brooklyn at her then husband, I believe's apartment, and the kitchen was the size of a coat closet. It was just like so claustrophobically small, and she was crying, being like, what the hell have I gotten myself into, you know, this is terrible, get me out of here. And then what he did was he went out and got her a cheesecake from Junior's, which, you know, for anyone who has been to New York, you know, is probably familiar with the famous you know, Junior's cheesecake or whatever. And after that, you know, she had just a bite of it and she was so smitten, and she said, you know, a country that has food like this can't be all bad. And I thought it was such a sweet little story that, you know, she relates to me just about, you know, her early days in America, and just, you know, those simple kinds of gustatory pleasures, let's say, that, you know, allowed her
pudding, a junior's cheesecake.
Banana pudding studded with milled wafers, you know, like that kind of stuff, you know. There are endearing stories like that that unfortunately had to get cut. But
you know, you could do volumes. I know you were, I'm not trying to limit you to this place, but it's that idea that there's like, there's so much there. It's also, there's so much for people to pursue. These stories are out there. There's so much to work with. Like,
I'm so excited for younger, more talented writers than myself to write better versions of this book in years to come. So
someone is asking, this is a good question related to that. Are there any folks working now in the food world you think deserve more attention?
Yes. Well, my answer to this originally was someone like Alicia Kennedy, but she's blown up deservedly. She is
a
great, great friend of mine. And she deserves every single minute of her stardom. I'm so glad. So Alicia Kennedy no longer applies. I will say to writers.
But she should get more paid subscribers. How about that? I mean,
she should, absolutely.
You know, like, she's making a living here, you know, like, she has a lot of attention, but
yeah,
we all still need.
You gotta give, open your wallets, exactly. You know, if you do have the means, please do support her, because she is very much an independent creator. But two other names who come to mind immediately are both writers based, or they write mostly about South Asian foodways. One is Sharanya Deepak, and she is based in India right now, and she has written for places like Eater and Gastro Obscura. She is a wonderful, thorough writer. And the second person who comes to mind is Vidya Balachander. She is the South Asia editor of Whetstone, but she's also written widely for many, many different publications, some of them American ones. And she writes with such nuance and grace about South Asian foodways broadly. And those are two writers who I feel deserve more attention than the American food media has given them thus far, at least from my perspective.
Great, thank you. Okay, so this is a question from Madeline. Hi, Madeline. I know Madeline, she's a very wonderful person.
Hey, Madeline.
as a reader, what strategies, questions, like basically what should Madeline be thinking about when trying to work to decenter whiteness in food media?
Yes, I think one thing that immediately comes to mind is just to be very skeptical and critical of any use of the first person plural. It's so tempting. And I realized when I reread, my introduction, you know, I occasionally use the first person plural and I try my best to be quite specific about who I feel belongs to that sort of group. But when you say something like, you know, we don't do enough of X, Y, Z, or we don't do enough of that. And it's like, you know, whom are you centering? I've often found that, you know, when I revisit my early writing and I use that sort of language, I am often centering a white reader and placating that very person whom I now no longer only want to write for. And so I would say that, you know, if you see that in someone's writing, like mine, for example, you should be like, are they defining who belongs to that group? You know, and are they just recentering dominant culture and the dominant population, and who is being left out of such a discourse? And it kind of ties back to what I was talking about earlier regarding, you know, the uses of words like a forgotten and overlooked as descriptors. You know, it's like, overlooked by whom, forgotten to whom? You know, perhaps these figures mean a great deal to people who belong to these very communities that these women belong to, you know. So that's just one thing that comes to mind immediately.
Yeah. I mean, I always ask myself, like, what's been left out of the story?
Totally.
And also, like, who benefits from this story?
Yes.
That's just another thought. That's something that comes up when I read things. And I'm like, totally. Okay, this is the last question. And I love this question very much. And
hopefully it's not about cooking.
What's next on your horizon?
Oh, wow. What a beautiful question. I have no damn clue.
I should say that is a very fair answer, since today is your publication day.
Yeah, it's wild, right? No, what is next? Who's to say? You know, we'll see if this book opens up any sorts of opportunities. Yet, you know, as I was kind of hinting at earlier, in my work as a professor or whatever at NYU, teaching food writing, I come across so many incredibly talented, hardworking students who they want to do this for the rest of their lives. They have this innate passion about food that I did not possess coming into this industry. I just kind of fell into it, you know, Alice in Wonderland style by total accident. And, you know, here I am. It's been such a lovely, challenging, but, you know, for the most part, quite lovely ride so far. Yet I want to make sure that I'm doing anything I can with whatever small influence or power I possess to make sure that, you know, these other much more talented, much more hardworking people who are younger than me, or emerging, let's say, don't have the same barriers to access that I had to fight against. And I hope that they don't need to have the same accolades to their name just to get attention, you know, and get enough capital to survive and make a living. And so I think that is where I'm going to focus quite a few of my energies. Yet, you know, I do also hope that moving forward that, you know, I love writing about food so much. And I hope that is clear when people read this book. Yet I grew up wanting to be a film critic, and I love writing about film. And I think that being fluent in different registers topically actually helps you in your food writing as well. And I want to make sure that I'm reminding myself that with whatever I do moving forward, and that I am giving myself the opportunity to write about other subjects, because I don't see myself abandoning food writing, of course, yet. You know, there are other interests that I have that I want to explore, and now feels like a nice time to do that. So
yeah, beautiful. Well, just so you know, I'll read everything you write.
Oh, thank you.
And I look forward to whatever it is that you do next. I know you're still in book promotion, and I also hope that you get rest and are able to take care of yourself and recover from this intense period.
Yeah, I'm just gonna fall asleep watching General Hospital at night, you know. I'm gonna watch soaps for the rest of my life. That is the answer to your question about what my future looks like. But
listen, you're a multifaceted person. You contain multitudes, and you can indulge them all.
Vanilla wafers, you name it. Yeah, well, thank you all so much for coming. And Angela, thank you so much for this amazing conversation. Oh, I really
thank
appreciate
you.
It.
Thank you. It's made my week. And I think Stesha is going to come back on and close us out.
Thank you.
Thank you both so much. That was a wonderful conversation. And I really do feel like we could be here talking about it all night. But we want to let Mike go to bed because he's on the East Coast or watch General Hospital. Sorry. Yeah. Exactly. So, book larder have copies of Mayukh's book and Angela's book. You can find the books at their website, booklarder.com. And of course, you can find both authors' books at the library, spl.org. I also put direct links to Tastemakers and Like a Mother in the chat. So if you just want to click a link, that's the easiest way to do that. We are so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you, Meghna and Laura at Book Larder. We love you guys.
Thank you,
Book
Larder.
Thanks for having us.
So much.
Yay. And we're grateful to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library. And of course, thank you to all of you for joining us tonight. We're so glad that you spent tonight with us, and we'll see y'all next time. Good night.
Good night. Thank you so
much. Good night,
much.
Everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.